I go here. I'm an undergraduate, and my major is management information systems.
He's the cameraman. He's the cameraman.
I'm the cameraman.
You're the cameraman.
I'm not a student. Like,
we call him. We call him King Gaffer, actually. His name is Gaffer. We call him King Gaffer.
So-called Dempster-Shafer theory of leaf functions had gotten being used by accountants, and so I came here to teach not accounting but information systems. And I taught auditing for a while. That's been some years back. But mainly I taught PhD students and taught statistical methods. That was probably most of my teaching. And then because I was interested in the PhD program, after I'd been here about 5 years, I guess, I got more involved in the administration of the school, and I was appointed director of the school's PhD program. Professor Govindaraj has that job now, but I had that job for 10 years. And so for 10 years, I only taught PhD courses then, because half-time I was directing the PhD program. I had some PhD students in accounting and information systems, graduated a few. And then in 2011, I was asked to be dean of the school temporarily. And the temporary turned into 4 years. So for 4 years, I was dean of the school. So that kind of left me, I didn't work with PhD students. I don't know, being dean of a business school is a 24/7. PhD students I was working with finished with some other professors, with Professor Kogan and Tunkai, I forget somebody's name, but anyway, they finished. Both went to the University of Miami, good jobs. But since then, so after that, I came back, and now I've been sort of offering a course in the things I'm interested in every year, and I don't get too many students, but that's fine. What am I interested in? And I've also been teaching in some other departments. I've been doing some teaching in account, in statistics, and in philosophy. I'm not an accountant, right? That's pretty clear. But I'm still having fun, and I'm going to tell you today about the things that I'm most interested in at the moment. which have some relevance to research in accounting and in accounting in a lot of fields. And then maybe I'll tell you a little bit about the, you know. So the course I'm going to offer next year will be in that spirit. It's sort of some new statistical methods that you have not encountered before that I think are worth trying out. I'll teach about that. Teach a little bit about game theory. Teach about some of my own work that I'll tell you about today. So this will be a little different. So you've seen my title. My title is called Hypothesis Testing as a Game. So in sort of every field of research, almost every empirical field of research, you do statistical testing. So hypothesis testing is a big subject, not just in accounting, but also in finance. Accounting information systems, maybe hypothesis testing is not quite so central because you're more interested in methods. But you're also doing things that are statistical in a different way. So that's kind of part of the mix of what I'll tell you about today also. I'll start with the hypothesis testing issue, which is, very broad, not just for accounting research, but for everybody doing empirical research in social science and even in medicine and so on. So I'm 71 years old. So I'm indulging my own, I'm going to teach for a few more years, and I have a few more years to write things that I think will have some influence. So I'm doing my own thing, I hope it's relevant. But I hope you're interested, but if you're not interested because it's not accounting, that's fine too. At this stage, I'm not trying to build an empire or get promoted or or make any changes or influence anybody. Okay, so how are we going to make this work? There we go. Oh, so I did tell, I was saying a little bit about this. I'm going to teach, so I am offering a PhD course next year as I am this year. This year I have about 8 students. Some of them are in accounting, most of them actually in finance. And I'm talking some of the things that in that class, and some of them are in information technology. There's a few students from there also. These are kind of some of the topics that I am talking about in that class, which I'll offer again next year. And I decided next year to offer it at basically Tuesday afternoon, because I noticed that the only thing on the PhD schedule in the accounting, in the business school, only thing on the PhD schedule in the spring on Tuesday afternoons is this seminar. So I thought, it's only first year students in this seminar, so if I offer it at the same time, there won't be any conflicts with anybody who's not a first year student. So that was my thinking. So I'll see if anybody wants to sign up. So you're welcome in this class. If it interests you, this time I'm calling the title of it Game Theoretic Prediction. So prediction is a topic that should be of interest, is of an interest to the accounting information system students I know. So I'm going to teach about some methods of prediction that are new, that come out of what I call game theoretic probability. I'm just finishing a second book on the topic with a colleague, a very mathematical book on game theoretic probability. I won't teach you the mathematical theory, but I'll teach some of the methods of prediction that are related to that. But I'll start by talking about pitfalls in statistics. So this is the problem, perennial problem. People think of it as something that's a crisis right now. How many of you have heard about the crisis of reproducibility? Crisis of reproducibility. Have you heard that term? How many of you have heard the term p-hacking?
P-hacking.
Have you heard this term? Okay, so you're blissfully innocent of these issues.
It's like it's a problem to another problem, like.
P refers to p-values.
Converting one problem to another problem?
That's no, it's about p-values.
Oh, okay.
How many of you know what a p-value is? How many of you don't know what a p-value is? Anybody looking for they don't know what a p-value is? So you do a statistical test, in the paper there's a p-value. To get the paper published, if you're in, say, if you're not, I don't know about AIS. AIS, we publish all kinds of stuff. But in accounting, if you're doing financial accounting, to get your paper published, you got to have a p-value. What kind of p-value do you need? 5%. Most places, it is significant if it's 5%. So if it's 5%, how do you get 5%? How are you going to do that? How are you going to get it to come out 5%? Well, the fact is, there's a lot of sort of cheating going on to make 5%. Obviously, anything in life where you know you get rewarded and there's a certain goal, people have ways of getting at that goal, and when those ways are not legitimate, it's called p-hacking. This is a new name for it. There was an older name when I was a student. When I was your age, we call it data mining. Now, what is p-hacking? P-hacking is when you try something, you don't get 5%. So you change the variable a little bit. Or you change which observations you threw out. Or you fool with it. You fool with the data. You fool with the hypothesis. You change the hypothesis a little bit.
Cooking numbers.
Pardon?
Cooking numbers.
Okay, cooking numbers. When I was a student, it was called a statistics student. I wasn't an accounting student. I was a stat. I was a student in a PhD in statistics. They called it data mining. Data. Now, that got confusing because now people think data mining is a good thing. So the computer scientist came along and took over the word data mining. And they said, oh, that's a good thing. We got all this data. We have to mine it. Well, sometimes they're doing exactly what we said they shouldn't do. They're trying to try this. You're an AIS, right? You try this, you try that, you try this. Okay, we've got all this data. We've got to see what we can learn from it. Kind of explore it. That's true. But in terms of calculating p-values, that's against the rules. The official rules for calculating the p-values are you start with the hypothesis before you look at the data. And you tell how you're going to test it before you look at the data. And then you do that. And then you look at the data and you say, oh, this is an extreme result. If this hypothesis were true, this would have happened only rarely by chance, less than 5% of the time. That's like 20 to 1 odds, or at least 19 to 1 odds. So I don't think that was that rare of it happened, so I think I have proved that hypothesis is false. And if that hypothesis said that something doesn't have an effect, then maybe it does have an effect. That's the logic. But if you didn't, if you tried different things before you. I mean, that p-value says this should only happen 1 in 20 times. But if you tried 20 things before you got it, okay. If you tried 20 things and you got it to happen once, then it's probably by chance you're cheating. What an accountant or a finance theory person would call this an agent problem. You ever heard that term, agent problem?
Yes.
You've heard the term agent problem. Have you heard the term agent problem?
I'm not sure. What is it?
Yes, we are not sure whether we are talking about the same agent.
Researchers does not act on their on public interest, but act on their interest only. So they are kind of
principal agent problem.
So when we talk about agent problems, we usually think about the CEO is supposed to be an agent of the shareholders. But if they're not really acting like an agent for the shareholders, but working for themselves, that's cheating, right? Agent problem, and that's, when people study this agent problem, they study it within game theory. Right, you've seen that. Or those of you who studied financial accounting for a while, you've seen this discussion about people talk about the game between the CEO or the manager of the company more generally and the shareholders and the regulators. They're all playing a game, and the problem that the manager may be acting in his own interest in a way that's not in the interest of the shareholders or even of the society, that's an agent problem. So that's a game theory. Okay, well, the same kind of thinking about game theory applies to you as a researcher. You're supposed to be an agent for the larger good, finding out whether what affects what. As a researcher, you're supposed to be an agent for our pursuit of knowledge, but maybe you're cheating. So this p-hacking is the agency problem for us, as in I'm including myself, even though I have not done it. I'm a theoretical statistician. I didn't do that much empirical research. But a lot of you are going to be working with data to try to prove or disprove things. So in that enterprise, where I've had a lot of students doing that, and I've done a little bit myself, so I'll say us. We are the agents for society, for this larger enterprise, and if we cheat, we're benefiting ourselves by getting promoted or getting a job, but we're not fulfilling the purposes that we're being paid for. Just like the managers being paid by the shareholders and not working for the shareholders. Agency problem. So here I'm interested in the agency problem, if you want to call it that, for us. And that, you know, I remind you of my title, Hypothesis Testing as a Game. That's what I'm talking about. So this is my first topic, Pitfalls in Statistics, and these kinds of problems about cheating to get the p-value is one of the pitfalls. I introduced this a moment ago by talking about the reproducibility crisis. Okay, so you will encounter, if you stay in the research domain, this is a term that you will encounter. It's recently, you know, it's gotten recently popular in social science, and eventually people in accounting will talk about it. Although it is more for people that do experiments rather than, it's been talked about by people who are doing experiments, not about people that are using archival data. Most of you are probably looking at archival data, but we do have a Professor Brown and some others are, is anybody working with faculty members that are doing experiments? But plan to do, any of you planning to work with faculty members doing experiments? Yeah, you do. Okay. So this is relevant. So the term reproducibility crisis comes out of psychology. So the problem there is it's a little different. Here in accounting and finance, the biggest problem is that we slice and dice the same archival data. Too many ways. And that's a crisis of its own. In this course, I will have people. We'll read some recent papers that have worried about this problem. I'm having my students read Professor Campbell Harvey recently stepped down as president of the American Finance Association, and in his presidential address, he talked about this problem, about the slicing and dicing. You know, we have now found 300 factors that affect the stock market prices, and every year we find 10 more, 20 more, whatever, it's just going up and up and up because people are just finding, you know, more and more ways to, and it doesn't mean anything. So that's the problem in the archival. But in the experimental world, what's the problem there? The problem there is the psychologist does an experiment. He says, will people be affected if we ask the question this way? So they do an experiment, you get 50 subjects, you get 100 subjects, maybe they're the students in your class. You to run this experiment, see what happened. No effect. I can't promise that. But maybe if I change this a little bit, the way I said it. So you keep, now, you know, that's not dishonest. In there, is it dishonest? No, it's not. I mean, what else can you do? You find out something doesn't affect you. Well, maybe I got a little bit wrong. Maybe I should try a different hypothesis. And so you keep going. And after 20 experiments, you get a 5% result. Well, I mean, the same issue is there. You put a lot more work into it. Maybe as an experimenter, you know, the cheating wasn't, you know, if you just got an archive of data, you can slice and dice it different ways very fast. You can try all kinds of things. Every week, you can try five new things. If you got to run an experiment with 100 subjects, every experiment is a lot of work. But eventually, the same kind of problems arise. What did you get that 5% because there was something going on? Or was it because you just had tried so many things you finally got lucky? So a couple years ago, you know, people have been worrying about this in psychology. They're not stupid. They realize this could be a problem. So a few years ago, a group of psychologists, very prominent people, said, let's organize an effort to reproduce the most famous results. This was called the Open Science Collaboratory. So a group of very prominent psychologists who did behavioral research, they said, let's test these things. So they went and looked at the top psychology journals for the year, I think it was 2007 or 2008, one of those years. So they looked at all the articles in the top psychology journals that year. Some of them were very famous. You read about them in the newspapers, their results. And there were about 300 papers published in those top psychology journals in that year. They took the ones that had gotten the most attention, and they farmed them out to people who had agreed to reproduce them. And this is an effort, because normally you cannot get a reproduced study published in behavioral research in psychology. Somebody already did the experiment, you do the same experiment again. You can't, well, what's this? Is it interesting? We already do that. So generally you cannot publish reproduced. It's a little different than medicine and biology. You can publish publish the same thing again. Because people want, they think that's part of their culture. Other labs should try it. If one lab gets it, that doesn't, you know, that's not convincing. You want a lot of labs to do the same result before you're going to buy it. And now, you know, it's not quite the same thing because they do so, they do their work so fast. It doesn't take them so long to do an experiment. And so, you know, you look at the CVs of those people in experimental biology or medicine, and you know, okay, every year they have a big lab. And every year they publish 200 papers with 40 people's names on each one. In that lab, yeah.
Do you think like technology would change the experimental method of the research?
That's an issue right now. We're talking about it.
Yeah. So
because the result of this study, what was the result of this study? The result of the study was that they ended up with 100 experiments. They didn't reproduce, they didn't try all 300. They just, after the first 100, after results came in from the first 100 studies that had all been published with 5% or better significance levels, roughly the result was that half of them were not reproducible. Half the results they did, and again, they didn't get a significant result. So this was published, and in that half, were studies that had been very, very influential. There's one you probably heard about sort of unconscious racial bias. That was one of the studies. Could reproduce it. Others that in the field of social psychology had been very influential. Some of them spanned whole industries of other papers related, and half of them could be reproduced. So. They don't know what to do about this. They're calling it the crisis of reproducibility. And some people are saying that, well, we should change the 5%. Maybe we should make it 1% or half of 1%. So roughly speaking, instead of two standard deviations, ask for three. That idea is on the table. A lot of people are proposing that. Of course, for the experimental psychologists, that means instead of doing 20 experiments to get a publication, they're going to have to do 100? You know, it's going to put the labs out of business. For the finance and accounting research, it may be easier because you just work harder. You just take longer. You can get three standard deviations. So this is the crisis in reproducibility, and it's one of the pitfalls in statistics that I'll discuss. And there's some papers there that I think any empirical researcher in business today should know about this one. It's not something that's going to help you get a PhD. It may hinder you in getting your PhD, but it's something you should be knowledgeable about. So that's one of my topics. The second one is what I'm going to talk about, actually, as I continue this afternoon, I'm going to talk about game-theoretic adjustment of p-values. In my course, I will talk about Bayesian theory. This is the Dempster-Shafer theory of belief functions. That's what got me hired in this department. I still think it's useful, but I'm not, you know, I was working on that 40 years ago. I did my work on that 40 years ago. It's not what's on the top of my head right now. But I should be grateful because that got me my job. So, conformal prediction and game theory forecasting, those are new methods of prediction. More interesting to the, I think, to potentially more interesting to the AIS students. They're things that you might actually do for predicting. And then I have, this is game-theoretic market efficiency. These game-theoretic ideas that I've been working on actually also can be used to understand things like CAPM and the equity premium in finance theory. So this is kind of a miscellaneous things that I'm interested in. So that's an introduction. I guess that was the purpose of this class, is for each professor to introduce what they do. So that's an overview of what I do and what I would teach about.
Can I take a picture of that?
Sure. It's also on the Blackboard side.
Oh, really?
Okay. These slides, I think the research assistant was here, posted these slides on the Blackboard site. Okay, so I'm going to talk about game theoretic probability now. I'm going to get very historical. Although I paused, did anybody have questions about what I've been talking about in my course? Let me talk about probability now. Oh, you had a question?
No.
Next semester, you're going to teach?
Next year.
Next year, okay.
This time next year, spring.
2018, yeah.
Spring
2019.
I'll be 72
then. You're like, actually.
My wife makes me go to the gym. We do, they call it senior water aerobics. The instructor has us do this and do this. You're so sweet. I'm going to talk now about history of probability. If you ever studied history of probability, and I suspect few of you did, if you ever did, I told my sister yesterday, I had a phone call with my sister a few days ago, and I said, I'm very interested in history of statistics. And she said, does statistics have a history? I said, everything has a history. Come on. So probability theory, a lot of people think of its history having started in 1654. Well, you know, whenever you say that something started at a certain time, it's always wrong. There's always somebody who's doing it before that. 1654 was these two French mathematicians, and you've heard both their names. I suspect you've heard the name Pascal. What's Pascal? How do you know the name Pascal?
Pressure measure.
Pressure. Pardon?
Pressure.
What else? When I was your age, we had a
computer language
called Pascal. That's gone. What languages do you use?
Python, C plus,
no,
C sharp.
C-sharp? You're kidding me. Is there a program called C-sharp?
Yeah, that's a Microsoft.
Oh, is that right? I didn't even know. And R, do you use R?
Yeah, R.
What program
is it? Python.
Python is a popular one, yeah. Anyway, there was a program language called Pascal when I was a student. But also, he's got famous in physics. How about Fermat? Have you heard his name? No, heard? How many of you have heard Fermat's name? What for?
My mass mechanics diffusion name was Fermat mass. When I was in Korea,
yes,
I'm private academic institutions for mass mathematics. The name of that institution was Fermat.
Oh. Well, if you read the newspapers, actually, there was a big deal a few years back about Fermat's last theorem. Somebody finally proved it. Fermat's last theorem said, it's only interesting to mathematicians, but it was famous because, what was the theorem? You know, you can find numbers like 6 squared is equal to 5 squared plus 3 squared. And there's a lot of other numbers that have the same feature. There's a lot of numbers that have the square, you got one square is equal to some 2 other squares. Well, as soon as a mathematician sees that, they wonder about, how about cubes? Can you do that? Can you find numbers so that z cubed is equal to x cubed plus y cubed? How about that? Can you find an example of that?
Cubes.
And Fermat said no. Fermat, who was the leading number theorist of his day, said, no, you can't do that. There's no numbers that you can do that with cubes. You can do squares. There's lots of examples of squares. That's just the simplest one. 36 is equal to 25 plus 9. That's the simplest one. There's no example with cubes. You can't do it with cubes. You can't do it with fourth powers. Only do it with squares. That's the only thing. Fermat said, I've proven that, but there's not enough room on this piece of paper to write down the proof. So Fermat was the most famous number theorist of his day, so everybody thought, well, what's this proof that is just a little bit too long to write in the margin of the book that Fermat was scribbling in?
Bunch of pages.
So it took 350 years for mathematicians to prove that you can't do it with cubes. 350 years. And the final paper that proved it, was hundreds of pages long, and it was based on thousands of pages of previous work. Finally, they proved Fermat was right. But evidently, it's very doubtful that he had a proof that he could write in the margin.
Yeah.
He must have thought he had an idea, but it wouldn't really work. That was Fermat's last theorem. So Fermat is a famous mathematician even today. This was only 10 years, time passes. Maybe it was 15 years ago. Maybe it was 20, I don't know. it was just a while back in my mind that this was finally proven. And it was a big deal in the newspapers. If you were interested in math, you heard about this. Pardon? It's only a few years ago. I'm thinking maybe 10 at least by now. Maybe 2005, 2008, something like that. So here's Blaise Pascal. Look, he's a young guy. He's 20 years younger than Fermat. So Pascal had an idea. Pascal proved something about betting, about probability. We'd say, he didn't call probability, he didn't say probability, but it was about betting. Pascal proved something, and he wanted to find out if the master if he had a new idea or not. So he wrote to Fermat. He said, I prove this. Can you prove it? That's the way they did in those days. You want to show that you're smart, you say, here's a problem I've solved. Who else can solve it? So he went to the top. He went to the top guy. And Pascal was in Paris. Fermat was in Toulouse. They're both French. But they did this by correspondence, because Fermat did not, Toulouse was a long ways away. It was in the mountains, southern France, in the mountains. Fermat was in Paris. They didn't just go back and forth in those days. So Pascal wrote a letter to Fermat and said, hey, I proved this. How about you? Can you prove it? What was he proved? What did he figure out? What he figured out was something that was called the division problem in French. In English, it's sometimes called the problem of points. That's a mistranslation of the French. It's an error in translation, but it's a general name. And the problem was, how do you divide the stakes in a game if you have to start, if you have to stop early? The game is a tournament. It's like the World Series in baseball in the United States. I don't know if you know the rules of the World Series in baseball. The two American League and National League winners, champions, the two champions play in the world, what we call the World Series, even though it's only an American or North American thing. And they can play seven games. But the first team that wins four games wins. So if one team wins four in a row right from the outset, that's over. But if the other team wins, you know, if they split the first four, then they keep playing until one team has four games. That's the first team to win four games wins. And it could go to seven. Once you've had seven games, one of the teams has to have four. So it can't go any more than seven. So the most exciting World Series go to seven games. But the ones where one team is just completely squashes the other one, that's over in four games. So these two people, Paul and Peter, were playing a game like that. And where we come into the story, Paul is only 2 points short, and Peter is only 1 point short. So this is a division problem. They have to stop now. So how should they do it? There's money on the table. They have put money on the table. They said, look, we're betting, you know, we're each betting we can win. I put a dollar on the table, you put a dollar on the table. The winner gets both dollars. Except it wasn't a dollar. In the story that Pascal wrote, for some reason, he said they put 64 pistoles on the table. Pistol was a monetary unit of the time, and it was actually quite a bit of money. So 64 pistols was something like $20,000. So Pascal made it serious. There's a lot of money on the table. And the first player to get to a certain number of points wins. At this time, Paul is 2 points short, Peter is 1 point short. So if Peter wins the next round, Paul gets zero. If Paul wins the next round, they're going to keep playing because he needs 2 points. If he then loses again, Peter wins, Paul still gets zero. But if Paul wins both games in a row, he gets 64 pistols. Okay, so that's if they kept playing. But they can't keep playing. They got to stop. Mother called. Mother said it's lunchtime. I don't know. Or something. The police have found out where they are and they have to escape. They aren't supposed to be gambling. I don't know, whatever. maybe it's a ball game and it's starting to rain. They're called off. Okay, so anyway, for some reason they have to stop. How much should Paul get? Here's the 64 pistols, we gotta divide the stakes. What do you think? How much should Paul get? I've stopped. We gotta stop and divide the stakes. We gotta quit playing and divide the 64 pistols. We can't keep playing so that one player gets all of it. Both players are entitled to something. They both have a chance of winning. Yeah.
16 pistols?
16. His answer is 16. How many of you agree with 16? Any other idea? Any competing idea? Okay, 16 is right. But actually, people had discussed this problem before, and there were no previous published results that had said 16. Other people had come up with other answers. This problem is discussed. How many of you know the name Pacioli?
Oh, everyone.
Everyone knows Pacioli.
He's the father of accounting.
Well, he's the first one that published. We don't really know if anybody had done it before. What we know is that the first time we ever see double entry accounting in a book, in print, is Pacioli's Summa Arithmetica or something like that in like 1600. Is that right? 1500. Is it 1500 or 1600? When did Pacioli publish that? 1650? No, it's before this. It might be 1560, something like that. So Pacioli's book is not just about accounting. Pacioli's book is about arithmetic. It's about, well, you put it aside. Pacioli's book is about business math. That's what it's about. But the truth is that in those times, all of math was business math. They didn't teach much math. You know, there were two kinds of institutions for teaching. There was the university. What did they teach in the university? In Europe, China was somewhat similar, actually. I don't know the details, but the Chinese universities were not that different 1,000 years ago. But I'm talking about right now in Europe in 1500. What were the major topics to teach in a university? Why did you go to a university? Anybody have any insight into that?
Theology?
Yeah. Yeah. There were three, actually, theology was the same. The universities were Catholic. They were religious institutions. And there were three schools in the universities, three graduate schools. The three graduate schools were theology, law, and medicine. That makes sense. Those are the things they wanted, they needed. Theology, law, and medicine. But then you had undergraduate stuff. So there was a little bit of math and astronomy thought to undergraduates. But the prestigious teachers were not the math teachers or the whatever. The prestigious teachers were teaching theology, law, and medicine. Those were the important things. So math was not a big deal. Not as big a deal. Where did you find people that were really interested in teaching math? You found them in business schools. And what were the business schools? So the business schools were in Italy, and then later in the other countries, they had what they were called, they called them abacus schools or reckoning schools. And that's where they taught algebra. They got algebra, they got the ideas from algebra from the Arabs. This is 1500, they're just learning things, you know, 1200, 1300, 1400, they're learning everything the Arabs do. And algebra was invented by the Arabs. That's an Arabic word, algebra. So they were learning algebra and teaching algebra. Algebra was not taught in the universities. Algebra was taught in these schools that trained 12-year-old boys to work for business.
So when was it?
Like 1500, 1400, 1500, 1600. The math teaching was going on in these schools for boys that taught them to work in business, for businesses, in business offices. As accountants, you could call them law accountants if you wanted to, but they had to do calculations for business. So that's where that Pacioli was writing a book. Now Pacioli, he wanted to teach in the university too, but he wrote this book for the business schools, for these reckoning schools, for the kids, these young men young boys who were going to learn to be the mathematicians or physicists. So of course he put accounting in his book. But he also had problems of contracts. If you've ever been in business, you know that contracts are never fulfilled. It never turns out the way you agreed to. Guy says, okay, I will fix your ceiling, and it'll cost you $400. Okay, he goes in and takes out, that's gonna be another $1,000, right? So a major problem in business is figuring out how to change the contract when unforeseen things happen. So this is a problem in contracts. You've got an agreement, but you've got to break the agreement off. So it's about games, but the game, that's a metaphor. The reason why you would teach this in a reckoning school is because it's about contracts. You've got to have somebody who really has ideas. What would you do if, how do you reason? How do you find it? Now, the two sides, everybody wants a contract to be fair. What does fair mean? Fair doesn't mean there is a right answer, and we've gotten to it. Fair means you and I are negotiating, and we've got to agree. Otherwise, we're going to get out of the knives, or we're going to have a feud that'll last forever. We've got to get into something. So we bargain, we bargain, we bargain. Both of us are saying, okay, that's fair enough. And we agree. So fair means fair enough. So the people who wrote about this problem were sort of saying, well, what is reasonable? What's some principle? So maybe it's reasonable. Maybe we should say a third. There's two ways Peter can win and one way Paul can win. So maybe a third is a good answer. Maybe Paul should get a third. A lot of people gave that as an answer. And in a sense, it's not a wrong answer, because if that's what you agree to, okay. You got to come to some agreement. But Pascal and Fermat thought, no, that's not the right answer. The right answer is 1/4. 4 through 64 is 16. But the interesting thing was they had different ways of getting that answer. Here's Fermat's way of getting that answer. Fermat said, Fermat wrote back to Pascal and he said, my answer is 16, and here's the way I get it. He said, there are four ways things can manage. So suppose they play two more rounds. Then there's four possible outcomes. Peter can win both games, Paul can win both games, or Peter can win the first, Paul the second, or Paul the first, Peter the second. That's the only four things that can happen. So of those four, only 1/4 gets Paul the 64, so he's only entitled to 1/4 of the 64. That's 60. That's it, that's it. And so that was what he wrote back to Pascal. Pascal said, well, I like your answer, but I don't like your argument. He said, I've been talking to other people about this problem. He said, somebody suggested this problem to me, and I gave this argument, and they didn't like this argument. He said, my friends don't like this argument. They said, it's just not, why don't they like it? For the obvious reason. You're starting out by saying something false. It's not true that they agreed to play two more rounds. If they kept playing, they wouldn't play two more rounds, necessarily. They might play two more rounds, but they might only play one. So there's not four ways things can come out, there's only three. You just look at the picture, there's only three. So Pascal said, I like your answer, but it's not a good argument. It's not an argument that will convince my friend. So what was Pascal's argument? Pascal said, I have a different argument. Pascal's argument used what we can now recognize as game theory. I call it game theory. I called Fermat's argument measure theory, because Fermat, you saw that word I wrote there, measure theory. Because Fermat was sort of saying, I count the cases and the fraction of them is going to be the probability. That's what we nowadays would call measure theory. But this Pascal's argument I would call game theory. Now, what's Pascal's argument? Pascal's argument was, He said, look, what are the terms of our agreement? Well, Peter and Paul, what did they agree to? Peter and Paul agreed to play at even odds. That's the story. Peter put 32 pistols on the table, and Paul put 32 pistols on the table, and their agreement was that the winner would take all. So that's their agreement. They're going to play at even odds. Now, if Paul won the next round, they would be in this situation. I'm covering that number. In this situation, and they'd be in a situation where Peter was going to get 0 and Paul was going to get 64. Excuse me. They were in a situation where if Peter won, Paul would get 0. If Paul won, he would get 64. Well, if we're betting at even odds in this situation, how much would Peter have to put on the table if he's betting at even odds to get that situation? He'd have to put 32 down. He would put 32 down. The other, you know, Paul would put 32 down. Peter would put 32 down, and they'd have this story. So in this situation, Paul's position is worth 32. Okay, now we look at this part. Paul, we're in a situation where Paul can either get 0 or 32. That situation is worth 16. That's what you have to put down to play it even on. So reasoning backwards, sometimes it's called backward recursion, reasoning backwards in the game tree, you come up with 16. And that was Pascal's argument. So they got the same answer. Pascal said, I'm glad the truth is the same in Toulouse as in Paris. We're okay, we're still friends. But they had different kinds of arguments. And so my line, my story, I'm just finishing a second book with my co-author about game-theoretic probability. And this usual way of teaching probability in, you know, advanced courses in math or statistics departments, or in the management science department here when we teach the MQF students, the usual way of teaching probability theory is measure-theoretic. So our idea is, okay, measure-theoretic way is one, game-theoretic is the other. So we have a new way of thinking about probability theory. And my claim is this new way of thinking about probability theory, well, I say new, Pascal was doing it, so I shouldn't say new. Our way, Pascal's way of thinking about probability theory can be useful for helping us to understand the agent problem, whether the agent is a manager or a researcher. So we can think about the game. We can really formalize the idea that what's going on is a game of hypothesis testing, for example. Or in the markets, if we're talking about finance theory, what I used to teach in the MQF program. So what I taught there, we could interpret in this game-theoretic way, makes more sense than the measure-theoretic way.
Professor, so to me it looks like for each state of the game, this is a very simple example here.
Yeah.
We could just generalize it in a bigger model or other real models. Do we use the sequential models where a series of
generalizing so it's not sequential? Well, I mean, one step, you could do a one-step game. You could do a game, there's a lot of theory you could do just about one round of betting. So the general idea is you interpret probability in terms of betting. But in markets, you know, we have many rounds of, every second is a new round of the stock market, for example. We take this thing, a sequential picture, as basic. Historians have brought out how much of ideas like this were going on it turns out people were doing this for at least 400 years before Fermat. And the most prominent evidence we have is a long poem with the title, the Latin title, De Betula. That was probably written about 1250. That's the 13th century, 1250. And it was used actually in the universities. So there was some teaching in the universities. And this poem showed how to calculate chances in dice games.
And he wrote in a poem.
In a poem. So that was kind of a, well, in those days, you know, if you wanted to write something, writing it in a poem was made it more accessible. So you wrote it in verse, and it was in Latin, of course, because everybody's speaking Latin. De Betula means old woman. And the poet, sort of in this poem, he tells, we think, we aren't sure, but we think this poem was written by the math teacher at the University of Paris. So underneath the graduate schools, you had somebody that was teaching math. And actually, they were teaching what was called the quadrivium for four. The undergraduate subjects were divided up into the quadrivium, which were four things, and the trivium, which were three. Have you ever heard the English word trivial?
Trivial?
What does trivial mean?
Important.
Pardon?
Important, like...
trivial means important?
Not important.
Not important.
Opposite.
So who would call it not important? Well, the people teaching the quadrivium are probably the ones that call the trivium not important. The quadrivium was math. It was astronomy, geometry, arithmetic, and music. Music was regarded as part of math.
Yes.
So that was the quadrivium. The trivium was grammar, logic, and rhetoric. So this was kind of the humanities were the trivium. And the mathematician over here didn't think much of it, so he called it trivium. Anyway, I mean, he called it what it was. It was the trivium. But he said it was a sneer, and so now we, that's the meaning of trivial. When a mathematician says something, it's trivial. You don't care about it. So we think this poem was written by the math teacher who was teaching astronomy. That was the big thing, astronomy. They thought they knew something about astronomy. And music and arithmetic and geometry, that's what he was teaching. And he wrote this long poem, and in the poem he kind of told about everything that people needed to know about music and astronomy. But he started out, the poem started out sort of being like, how I wasted my youth and what I did that you shouldn't do. So what is it that he did while, what that you shouldn't do? Sex and gambling, of course. So while he's talking about gambling, he tells how to do it. So, he says, here's how you calculate the chances, but it's not going to do you any good because you're going to lose all your money anyway. You shouldn't do it. But before he does gambling, he does sex. He says, this is how you do it. Well, he didn't go into that kind of detail, but he talked about how to deal with women and how to get on their right side, and tells about his history. And his history was that he spent many years trying to seduce the girl of his dreams, and he finally succeeded. But when he woke up the next morning with her, he found out it was an old woman. Well, actually, you know, this is even, well, that happens to a lot of us, but then you're the old man, too. When you get to this stage. So that was Neyman's book. So this dice games, kind of the chances of dice games, this idea that Fermat was using, he didn't just invent it in 1654. It had been written about for hundreds of years, at least, probably much longer than that. But we have it right, we have this this document where it's written down 400 years earlier. And the same thing with, you know, Pascal's method. Now, as we said, Pacioli wrote about this problem. A lot of people wrote about the problem. But until recently, we didn't know that anybody had gotten it what we think is right, what we consider the right answer. The right probability answer is 16 out of 64. We didn't know anybody had gotten that answer. But in the last 20 years, there have been two Italian manuscripts discovered that got the right answer. They were obviously written for the abacus schools. And one of them that got the right answer is very interesting because in the document, the abacus master, the master of the abacus schools, is saying, keep this a secret. He says, I'm telling you how to do this, but this is part of our expertise. I'm teaching you to be part of our guild, and we are like consultants to businesses. And don't tell anybody else because, you know, this is part of our secret knowledge. So how did Pascal find out? But anyway, this was like, this was 200 years earlier, 200 years before Pascal. We have a document by an abacus master saying, you know, this is how you do it, but keep it a secret. So the knowledge was around. Maybe Pascal made it up himself, or maybe that was percolating around, and there were other people that did it that way, and somebody explained it to him. Who knows? We may never know. So here is a picture of the history as I see it. I told you about the abacus schools and Pacioli. These ideas of these abacus schools came from North Africa, from the Arabs. And of course, it's the Arabs that discovered algebra, and the word algorithm is also Arab.
He's actually from Central Asia, Uzbekistan. But he worked in for Arab. It was all Arab.
It was all Arab. He was speaking Arab. I didn't say.
Why are you so mad about it?
No, I didn't say Arab mathematics.
No, Arab mathematics is a language.
Yes.
Yeah. This was the flourishing of science in the Middle Ages was Arabic. Yes. It was done in Arabic. Much of it was done by Persians.
Yes.
Much of it was done by Jews. Some of it was done by Christians. They weren't all Muslims. And their native language may not have been Arab, but the Arabs were in charge. And they were writing in Arabic. That was the age of Arabic. So the best way to describe it is Arab mathematics. So the best work in astronomy was done in Tashkent. But that was part of the Arab world. Al-Khwarizmi is what we get the word algorithm from. And he actually did that, I think, in the 9th century.
Yes.
Was his work. So it's very early in the period, the Muslim period. But he did it in Arabic. And we know that that influenced North Africa. They developed algebra in North Africa, and the Italians got it from North Africa, translated it from Arabic into Latin. And they did it as, how did they have those contacts? Because of business. Once Europe got prospering again, I mean, in the 9th century, there was no, in the 9th century, the Christians were, you know, Europe was nothing. The Arabs wouldn't even bother to try to trade with Europe. There was nothing there. They didn't have any political organization. But by the 12th, 13th, 14th centuries, there was a lot of the Europeans were developing a lot of commerce, and so they were trading with the Arabs. And also the Arabs were divided, and they weren't just sort of dominating everything, so there was a lot of trade going on. And so the business people, so Fibonacci, have you ever heard the name Fibonacci? Famous Italian mathematician Fibonacci. He learned he's the one that brought decimal numbers from the Arabs. The Arabs had gotten the idea of decimal numbers from the Indians, but it came to Europe from the Arabs, and Fibonacci got it when he was a child with his father on business trips. So these idea of these reckoning schools was an idea, I'm sure, the whole idea came from North Africa into Italy and southern France, and then spread to England and France and Germany. So that's where these ideas of dividing states and business contracts was that way. But also, the universities started learning the Arabic knowledge and translating it into Latin around the same time. And most of that, the biggest activity there was in Spain. So the Spanish, around the year, in the same period, 12th century, 13th century, there was a tremendous amount of translation going on. And again, the translators were Christians, Arabs, Muslims, but they were working to translate the Arabic knowledge into Latin, and sometimes into Spanish. And then, now of course, the Arabs didn't invent it all. Their knowledge of astronomy came from the Hindus and especially the Greeks. Their knowledge of math came from the Hindus, largely. And of course, the Greeks and the Hindus, you can trace their knowledge back to the origin of arithmetic and writing in Babylonia and Samaria 4,000 years ago. There are these little, the so-called cuneiform tablets. The first writing that we know about were on these little clay tablets and the writing script seems to have been invented by the Akkadians and Sumerians about 4,000 years ago. There are now millions. These tablets were very durable, especially in the climate of the Middle East. There's probably a million of these that have still not been translated. What's on them? Do you know what they wrote on these tablets? Well, why were they writing on tablets? What was it about? Do you have any idea? Usually, the vast majority of them are contracts. You will bring me this much wheat on this day, and I will pay you this much, and if you don't bring it, I get your slave.
Yeah.
Whatever. Any kind of contract. How do you make a contract with somebody? You need a record of it. Business needs records. So, you can't, one person thinks we said this, the other person thinks we said this, you need to write it down. So the invention of writing was a result of business, it was contracts. It's very interesting. People studying finance have got interested in the history of options. So they want to know when were the first options or derivatives traded. So first they realized, people were doing this in the 19th century because you've got books about it in French. Wait a minute, people were doing it in the 12th century, because you find older things. So they kept going back and back and back. Where they end up 4,000 years ago. Because you could find all these tablets are about contracts, and a lot of the contracts are futures contracts, or options of one kind or another. If this doesn't happen, you pay me this. There's no way to describe that, it's a derivative. So we don't know how far back these ideas go. We know we find dice. We find very good dice from 4,000 years ago. This is a picture of one from the Art Institute of Chicago. There's really four. The fourth hole here has been blocked up, but there's only four on this side. It's a very symmetrical, well-balanced die. So these ideas of gambling and dice go back very far. This is a picture from 1283. I just love this. It's so beautifully painted. So the king, this is during this period when the Europeans were translating the knowledge from the Arabs. And there was a king of Castile. Castile was the first first Christian kingdom that occupied most of Spain. As you may remember, the Muslims had conquered Spain. And then it got divided into a bunch of kingdoms, and there were little Christian kingdoms and Muslim kingdoms, and there was a lot of intermixture at that time. But gradually there was one king, the King of Castile, got control of most of the Spanish peninsula. And there was a period of relative peacefulness when Alfonso the X, he's sometimes called Alfonso the Wise, because he was very interested in knowledge, and he commissioned his people to write books about all the known, in Spanish, or Castilian at that time, of all the known knowledge of the world. And one of his books was a book of games. And this book is beautifully illustrated, and it illustrates all the games, all kinds of games, ball games, dice games, different kinds of games, and every game has a page with a picture of the game. Beautiful painting. And this is a picture of one of the dice games. His dice games all involve three dice. The poem I told you about before, about the old woman, the game there is also three dice. Many of the dice games involve three dice. You throw three dice. So in this picture, you see this group of players are throwing three dice, and this group of players are throwing three dice. And one thing I love about the picture is you can see the numbers that come up. I guess they didn't know how to do perspective. So this should have been a horizontal table. And you're seeing the dice as it's fallen on the table. But you see these dice add up to 15. There's two sixes and a three. And here you've got a four and two ones. That adds up to six. And the rules of this game were that to win, when you threw, you had to either get three of a kind, all three of the dice coming up the same, or 15 or more, or six or less. So both of these are winning throws. That's the significance of the choice of the picture. So in this game, you can calculate. If you know how to do calculations like Fermat did, you can calculate that the probability of winning on one throw is almost 1 in 5, about 20%. And of course, the way the game is played, as I say, you alternate throws. One player throws first. If he doesn't get it, the next player throws, and they go back and forth. So the first player obviously has the advantage. He has the first chance of winning. But you can calculate what his advantage is, and it's about 55%. These calculations are not in this book. But the author of the poem about the old woman could do these calculations. And you kind of see why. What would you have to do to give the first player less advantage? If you wanted to make it more even and give the first player less advantage, how would you change the rules for a throw of winning?
So what are you saying here is like the first player who's gonna throw the dice is gonna win 55%.
That's right. Yeah, his chance of winning is 55%.
And
he's only got a 19% chance of winning on the first throw.
On the first throw.
But he could also win on the third throw. And he could also win on the fifth throw, because he makes every other throw. If the second player, if he doesn't win on the first, if he doesn't get three of a kind or 15 or more or six or less on the first throw, the other guy's got a chance. I guess these are all men in this picture. I don't know. So, you know, and the second guy might win, and then the game's over. But if the second guy doesn't get a winning throw, then the first player has a chance again. So I've calculated that, and I know that the total, you add it all up, his total chance of winning is 55%, which is not, you know, that's, if you only have a 45% chance of winning, it's still fun to play. You know, it's not, 55% isn't a real big advantage. So you can imagine, you know, maybe you'll, if you play this a lot, maybe both players would have their turn at starting first, but, you know, it's fun still. If you're the second player, you've got a good chance because he's only got a 20% chance of winning the first throw. But I'm saying, what if you wanted to bring this, what if you wanted to bring this 55% down? Yeah, what would you do?
Maybe to let the second player to throw as well, to continue after.
They throw at
and
the same time.
Until one of
the
them
time.
One of them loses.
What if they both win?
But they continue
the
till they
yeah,
one
the
all lose.
They both win here.
Pardon?
Here in the picture, they both win.
No, two different games.
It's like you said 15 or greater.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. These are two different groups of players.
Oh, okay. But let's say that they.
So that's an idea. You could have them, you could change the rules of the game so they both throw.
The same time.
And then you keep going if only you need to break a tie. That would work. That would make it even.
But what I was
trying to get at was that if you made it harder to win on any single throw, then the first player would have less advantage.
Oh, so you throw each dice individually?
No. There's three ways of winning.
Yeah.
You win if you get a three of a kind, or you get 15 or greater, or six or less. What if we changed the rules so that to win you had to get three of a kind?
Okay. So wouldn't that also decrease the second player's probability?
If you had to get three of a kind to win, what's the probability of that?
One of six thirds.
What's the probability you'll throw three dice? What's the probability of getting a six of a kind, a three of a kind?
One over 36, is that right?
There's a probability of 1/36 of getting all ones.
There are six combinations and 261.
Right. So the probability of getting three ones is 1/36. One is 1/216.
Yeah.
Probably getting three twos is 1/216. There's six of those, you add them up. So 1/36, which is only about 2%, 3%, around 3%. So if you move the, if you want to make it more fair, that actually would bring this 51% down to about this 55%. If you made it that hard to win the first time, you would bring the 55% down to about 51%. Why didn't they do it that way? What's the disadvantage of that?
You keep playing and playing.
Right.
You keep playing, it's hard to win, so it
takes a long time. Takes a long time. If the probability of winning the first time is about 1/5, 20%, on average, it'll take you about 5 throws to win, to get a winner. If the probability was only 3%, it would take you 30 throws to get a winner. That's too boring. Who wants to go 30 rounds before you play a winner? Five is okay. That's exciting. 5 throws, you do that pretty quick. Get a winner. So this is a well-designed game and a beautiful picture of it. And it was done in the 13th century when people could already calculate the rules of games and chance. Okay. So that's the entertainment. You see, my class is so entertaining. I'll just show you pictures. but now I get sort of theoretical. So I say, I've told you that I'm looking at a difference between measure theory probability and game theory probability. And I'm going to talk about how we define probability and how we test the hypothesis with these two points of view. Now, actually, I didn't even, when I was doing this story here, I didn't talk about probability. I just talked about betting and about dividing the stakes. But of course, I said that Paul is entitled to 1/4 of the 64. That's kind of like saying the probability is 1/4. So we have a definition of probability implicit in this story. We can pull out of the story a definition of probability. And we can also pull out of Fermat's story. You know, again, Fermat was saying 1/4 of the ways things can happen. So the probability is 1/4. So underneath here, they didn't use this word. Pascal and Fermat did not use the word probability. We've invented that word after, I mean, the word probability meant other things at their time. But just sort of talking about probability as a number is something we've invented since Pascal and Fermat. So it didn't come at the dawn of human history. It's something new, but you can see how it would come out of these guys' ideas. So let me talk about, so I've got the measure-theoretic definition and the game-theoretic definition of probability. So the measure-theoretic definition is the fraction of equally likely cases in favor of the event. There's four equally likely cases. One of them favors Paul getting the money. And so the fraction that favors that event is 1/4. That's the probability. That's the difference. So you probably took some course in some place in your education, you probably saw this definition. Am I wrong? Do you remember seeing this before? Do you remember seeing this idea? How did they define probability when you were in school? Did you ever have a course where they talked about probability?
Finding frequency.
By frequency. Mm. Is that probability is the frequency of something happening?
Count of all successful events over all events. That was the general definition we were given.
Is this the same thing?
Yeah.
I mean, the frequency idea is a different idea, a little bit. Frequency idea would be, what if we played this over and over and over? But there's no playing over and over and over here. It's just one. We've been playing this game. We've got to settle it.
When you say that this is a probability,
$0.25 to get $1 if Paul wins the tournament. So we could, this could be like, if you have a friend, if you're betting on a World Series, and you have a friend who likes one team and you like the other team and you agree to bet on even odds, I mean, you might not think they have the same chance of winning. He might think his team is more likely to win, and you might think your team is more likely to win. But you can still say, well, we're betting on even odds. You know, we're making a 50-50 bet. So if that's the rules, you could use this kind of reasoning to define how much of a risk. There's so what about hypothesis testing? What is the I start off by talking about the problems with hypothesis testing and saying this game-theoretic approach might enable us to do hypothesis testing better. So what is the measure-theoretic way? Well, to test the probability model, you choose an event that has small probability according to the model. The model might have a null hypothesis in it. The model says this doesn't make, this variable doesn't make any difference. And you're going to test that. And you test that by identifying an event that has probability 5%. That's a significance level. And you reject at that small probability, that significance level, if the event happens. So there's an alpha missing right here, I guess. This looks like a PDF, so I can't put the alpha in. So you choose an event at E, to which the model assigns a small probability alpha. And if the event E happens, you reject this again as another alpha. Alpha might be 5%. That's major theory. But while I've been talking, you've read what I said about game theory. If you want to test probabilities game theoretically, you bet against them. You say, okay, those are your probabilities. Put your money where your mouth is. I'm going to make some bets at your probabilities, at this model's probabilities. So you're the model. You're the model. I'm going to show you're wrong by making money at your. I'm going to interpret the probabilities you're given as offers to bet, and I'm going to choose some bets, and I am going to make money from you. So, if you say that probability event E only has probability 5%, I'm going to interpret that as a offer to allow me to make a bet. At those odds, 19 to 1 odds. So you're going to give me 19 to 1 odds. I'm going to put 5 cents on the table, and you're going to put 95 cents on the table because you're so sure this event is not going to happen. You're going to put 95 cents on the table, I'm going to put 5 cents on the table. And the event is going to happen, and I'm going to get your 95 cents. And I will have multiplied my money, my 5 cents, I multiplied it by 20. What more could I do to show that your theory is a bad theory? Your theory gave probabilities, I bet on those probabilities, I multiplied the money I risked, multiplied my money by 20. What do you want? You want me to multiply it by 100? Okay, maybe I can do that. But there's really no other, what other way would I, what better way is there to show that a probabilistic theory is wrong than to bet against it? If those are the probabilities, put your money where your mouth is, I'll win. I'll multiply my money. So this is the game-theoretic probability philosophy, sort of that this is, in the end of the story, this is the only way, is to bet against it and win. You know, you can say, well, you were just lucky, but if your probabilities mean anything, it means you're predicting that that wouldn't happen. And I made it happen.
So when you have a distribution, normally we use
general statement. You're giving me examples. There's lots of probability models, a lot of statistical models. It could be a test that was chi squared, it could be a test that's t, it could be a test that's normally distributed. But in every case, you always identify an event that has small probability. Like the event of small probability might be the chi squared is going to be that big. Or that the t statistic is going to be, absolute value of the t statistic is going to be more than 2. That's the event E. So this is a general idea that applies to all kinds of statistical testing. But I'm saying the right way to do statistical testing is to think of it as a betting strategy. That I have a betting strategy and I show that betting strategy makes a lot of money, that refutes the hypothesis. Now, I'm going to relate that, but I should pause. I'm going to relate this to the idea of a p-value. How is this related to p-values? There's a little something there. But before I do that, do you have other questions? Anybody else? So I'm going to talk more about p-values, but first I want to talk about market efficiency. How many of you have, so do you take a course in finance, in the finance company? So do you study, in your finance course, do you study the efficient market hypothesis? Okay, what is the definition of an efficient market in your course? Speak louder so I can. So you didn't take that course?
I had, but there's an underground level corporate finance.
So did anybody have a course where they taught about testing market efficiency?
One thing that I learned about is that you test whether there is gross earnings drift, the pricing for all the information available in the same way.
But how do you test it? What is it?
You give news, then the market incorporates good or bad news to the price.
How do you test when you do that?
Me?
Yeah. How do they test in that theory? How do they test it? How do they test whether the market has done the right thing?
Because react the same. No.
Okay. So what I'm fishing for is for somebody to say the word joint hypothesis problem. Do you remember that from a finance? If you took a finance course, joint hypothesis problem. If you took a more advanced course, perhaps than the ones you were required to take, in the finance department, when they're talking about market efficiency, the classical papers on this topic and the sort of classic books, maybe if you look at your corporate finance book and look it up, Joint Hypothesis Probability Index, you might find it. So the joint hypothesis problem is a problem about testing market efficiency. So the people that created this theory of market efficiency, maybe you know the name Eugene Fama? So Eugene Fama got a Nobel Prize for his theory of market efficiency and his work on it. But he, in his papers about market efficiency, he says, well, there's a problem with testing it. And the problem is that you can't test market efficiency by itself. You have to add a model for how expectations are formed. You have to give a model, an economic model, for how information is used to form expectations. And so you're not testing market efficiency by itself. You're testing market efficiency and that model. So that if you fail, if the test fails, it may not be market efficiency that you rejected, it may be the model. And there's really no way out of that problem. You're always really not just testing market efficiency, you're testing the model. This is not my criticism of what they're saying, that is what they're saying. That is what Fama says over and over and over. So, but my comment about that is that the standard established theory of finance does not have a way of testing market efficiency. That's the way I summarize what they say. They say it in a more complicated way. They say there's a joint hypothesis problem, you're really going to test, you really have to test joint efficiency together with the model, and if you reject it, maybe the model is the problem, you can never be sure that it's market efficiency that's the problem. That's the way they say it. That's one way of saying it, but they also, another way that they say it is that you are testing the joint hypothesis. Market efficiency plus model as the joint hypothesis. So this is why they call it the joint hypothesis problem. You always have to test the joint hypothesis. You can't test market efficiency by itself. Now, in this approach, we have a way of testing market efficiency by itself. Okay, so we have a way of doing things that's a little different. How do we test market efficiency by itself? We try to multiply our capital by a large factor. Okay, here are the prices. We see the prices. That's what you got all this data. That's the prices. Let me start saying, okay, here's my strategy for trading. I'm going to have a strategy of trading. Now, that strategy has to start with a certain amount of money, and it can't risk more than that amount of money. So, now one problem is that my strategy, unless I make some assumptions, additional assumptions, I better not go short anything. Because if you go short, how much do you risk? I mean, what am I've got a certain amount of money I'm going to risk in the market. Okay, I got $100. So maybe I could buy $100 worth of Google. That's not a whole share. Maybe somebody will sell me $100 worth. Okay, if that goes down to $95, then the next day I've only got $95 to work with. So next day I put my $95 in some other stock. If that goes up to $105, then I got $105 to work with. That would be So I got to tell you in advance what my strategy is.
Professor, is the risk related to the time too?
We could worry about interest rate, couldn't we? But let's say that I am a trader in a large bank, and so I don't keep my money in cash. I keep it in a money market account at the risk-free rate. Okay. So I start with a certain amount of money in my money market account, and I move that money in and out of the money market account into various stocks. And I have some strategy for doing that, depending on how the prices change, and depending on whatever else other information I have. But I got to have some strategy that I specify in advance. If that strategy turns my $100 into $1 million, I've multiplied my money by 10,000. That's a significance level of 1/100 of 1%. Right, one over out, the amount of your money you multiply, let's go back there. Significance level alpha is like money multiplying your money by 1/alpha. So if I rejected a significance level 5%, I've multiplied by money by 20. Okay, so by the same principle, if I trade at the market prices, and I multiply my money by 20, I can reject market efficiency at 5%. If I multiply my money by 100, I can reject market efficiency at a 1% significance level, and so on. If I multiply my money by 1 million, I can reject market efficiency by a 1 in 1 million significance level. So this is a game-theoretic way of testing market efficiency. So in the book that we will publish, my co-author and I are doing the second book. We wrote a first book in 2001, published it. Our second book on game theory and probability has 5 chapters on financial markets. And that should be published at the end. We're aiming to publish at the end of this year. It's almost finished. So when I teach this course in the spring, I'll have this book to wait for. It's very mathematical. I won't teach from the book. This course, I'm not teaching the book, but I'll wave it around to show you that we published it. And that somebody else has the idea this makes some sense. So this is a different idea from the standard idea that you're applying finance theory. Now, there aren't that many people that multiply the money they risk by a large factor in the stock market. You hear about people that get rich in the stock market and they exist, but how do they do it? They do it by risking other people's money. George Soros, when he got so rich, he didn't. That wasn't with his own money. He didn't take $50 and multiply it by 1 million. He found some other people with a lot of money, and he multiplied their money by 2. And he took half of it as a commission. That's how he got rich. And usually the great successes, that's the way they start. They don't start with just a little amount of money and multiply it by a big factor. So there aren't a lot of examples out there of people getting rich that refute market efficiency. Now it's also true that there's a trading cost. And nobody is claiming that the market is more efficient than those transaction costs would allow. So if I have a strategy that I look at some data and I say, oh, my strategy would have multiplied my capital by 1,000 if there were no trading costs. One good question would be, well, how big a transaction cost? How many basis points for each trade would it have taken to wipe out your strategy? So you can measure, not only can you test market efficiency, but if you find a rejection of market efficiency, you can talk about how inefficient the market is and calibrate that by transaction costs. So there's a whole theory here about game-theoretic market efficiency. That's one of the, when I talked about my syllabus, I said that's kind of item number 7. So it's not something that in my course next year I would put a lot into, but I would probably give you one lecture at least to told how we get cap in and things like that out of this thing. Okay, but I want to spend more time on the idea of p-values, because I started out my talk by trying to give, it turned out that you were not already worrying about this question, but I started out by trying to convince you that it's a big issue right now about the validity of p-values. So I want to start out by saying that p-values are not quite game theoretic. So when you took a stat class, you all study statistics somewhere. I think when you say statistics, did you learn about type 1 error and type 2 error? How many of you never heard of type 1 and type 2 error? Okay, so you've heard about that. So what I want to point out is that type 2 and type 1 error, that theory of testing hypotheses, where you have type 1 and type 2 error, is a little different than using p-values. It's not quite the same. So the type 1 and type 2 error, that theory is called the Neyman-Pearson theory. Writing down there some words that you learned in your stat class. You may not have learned the names of names. Well, it's kind of hard to read that. Can you read it? Can you see what I wrote there? Maybe green was not the best choice, but black, I suppose I should use black. So I don't know if you heard that, if you remember the names Neyman and Pearson. Do you remember being told that this was a Neyman and Pearson theory? So that's kind of inside baseball, inside, you know, I'm a statistician, so I know I learned a little bit of the history just growing up. Neyman and Pearson were two statisticians that came up with this theory. And they talked about type 1 and type 2 error, and in their theory, alpha, like that's our 5%, is the probability of rejecting if the hypothesis is true. So in their theory, you're supposed to choose the rejection region. If this happens, I reject. And that's got to be something that happens 5% of the time if the theory is true. So the probability of rejecting if it's true is 5%. Now, that's not what people really do. What people really do is report the p-value. And that's a little different. Why is it different? Because you don't say in advance, you know you need 5%. You know that. You know, you aren't going to get it published unless your p-value is less than 5%. But you're actually hoping for even more. You'd like a p-value of 2%. Then you can say, this is really good. So you don't want to do what Neyman-Pearson told you to do. You don't want to say, I'm going to reject. And Neyman-Pearson said, you should write your paper this way. Don't put any p-value in there. Just say, this is my test. I'm going to reject if this happens. Period. That's it. No, you don't want to do that. Because if it's 2%, instead of if you get a p-value that's less than 2%, you don't want to say, oh, I was going to reject if it was less than 5%. You want to pretend that you were aiming for 2% and got it. So you put the p there, and you put a one star, or you put two stars, or something like that. Okay, from Neyman-Pearson point of view, that is cheating already. Because you didn't really say what the test was to start with. I mean, the game theory point of view is that you say what your strategy is and you bet. So you got to decide at the beginning whether you're going to bet on getting a 5% of it. You're going to decide whether to bet on something that the theory says only happens 5% of the time, and you multiply your money by 20, or whether to bet on something the theory says only happens 2% of the time and multiply your money by 50. You got to decide what's your. You got to decide what the bet is. Is the bet a 20-to-1 bet, or is the bet a, no, excuse me, is the bet a 1-in-20 bet, or is the bet a 1-in-50 bet? Which is it? Game theoretically, you got to decide the bets. And Neyman and Pearson, these guys that did this theory in the 1920s, 100 years ago, wasn't that long ago when I started. I started studying statistics in the late 60s. It was only 50. It was only 40 years ago. It was a new theory when I was a kid. Right. So anyway, Neyman-Pearson said you got to decide. And actually, there was a time in the 70s and 80s when a lot of psychology journals and a lot of journals in social science would not let you publish the p-value. They made you say, what is the significance level you're going to use, and what is the rejection? You have to decide. So they were more game theoretic back then. But now they went up, and all the business journals, they let you publish p-values. So the p-value, from a game theory point of view, the p-value is cheating a little bit. What is it doing? So let me put that in. That's what I write here. The p-value is not a legitimate game theoretic test. Significance level. Because what it is, it's the probability the model gives to being bigger than what you actually observe. That's P. P is the probability that the test statistic comes out bigger than what you observe. And you can say that the probability that P value is less than or equal to alpha is less than or equal to alpha, no matter what alpha is. When you calculate P as the probability that this is greater than or equal to that, it is mathematically true. This would take a little bit of math, but I think intuitively, if you worked with this statistical testing for a while, you may realize intuitively the probability that your P value is less than 1%, the probability of that happening is less than 1%. And the probability of your P value being less than 2%, the probability of that happening is less than 2%. That's true. So if you've got a p-value less than 2%, and it's true, you can tell me, oh, something happened that happens with probability less than 2%. But if you're telling me that you got that low p-value, I would say to you, well, something with low probability always happens. But the point is that you're supposed to choose it in advance and make a bet on it. You know, it's cheating for me to take the data and say, oh, this happened, this only has this very small probability, because always there's something happens with a low probability. That's not the point. The point is that something happens that you selected in advance and bet against that has low probability. That shows your theory isn't good. If I've got information that allows me, if I have information that allows me to bet against you and make a lot of money, then I have discredited your theory. But I can't do that unless I pick it out in advance. So that's why not picking it out in advance is cheating a little bit. It's not cheating as much as if you just picked anything out and say, this is a rare event. But it's cheating a little bit. You didn't do that. You didn't just pick out anything, because you did pick out the test. So you narrowed down the things that you were going to claim as rare events under the theory. So you cheated a little bit. So the question is, how do we adjust for your having cheated a little bit? How can we turn the p-value into something legitimate from the point of view of game theory? Here is an idea for how to do that. You see, if I had picked out 5%, if I had said the t statistic, I'm going to reject that the t statistic is bigger than 2, and the probability that is 5%, then I know what I'm doing. I make a bet, and if it comes out bigger than 2, I multiply my money by 20. And so 5% is my evidence against the hypothesis. It's fine. But now I'm dealing with the fact that you would like to get more credit if the p-value comes out less than 1%. And you'd like to get even more credit than that if the p-value comes out less than 0.1%. So what am I going to do? Well, what are you going to do? Or anyway, so my idea would be, okay, I won't just bet $1 on it coming out less than 5%. I'll bet $1 on it coming less than 5%. I'll bet $1 on it coming less than 1%. And I'll bet $1 on it coming out less than 0.1%. So I bet $3. $3. Okay, so what happens if it comes out 4.5%? I've won one bet and I've lost 2 bets. If it comes out 4.5%, I've won 1 of my 3 bets. So I put $3 on the table, and how much did I get back? I got 20. Because one of the bets, I put a dollar down to get 20, and I got the 20. But I missed out on the 100 and the 1,000. So my $3 has turned into $20. So how much did I want my capital? 20 divided by 3 is like 7, a little bit less than 7. Well, that doesn't win any prize. I mean, that's not bad if you multiply your money by 7. I wouldn't mind multiplying my money by 7. But it's not good enough to say you can reject that hypothesis. Nobody would, you know, give you what is, you know, 3/20, that's a significance level of 15%. Nobody is saying you can reject the hypothesis at a significance level of 15%. That's an impressive enough. So that's multiplying your money by 7. Okay, what if it comes out less than 1%, but not less than 0.1%? What if it comes out at 0.5%? Then I've won 2 bets. One of the bets has given me $20, one of the bets has given me $100, so I got $120. But I lost, but I put 3 down. So I've turned $3 into 120. I've multiplied by 40. That's not so bad. Multiplying your money by 40 is a significance level of 2.5%. So that will get it published. So, but it came out. It didn't come out. I said it actually came out 0.5%, but I don't get to claim credit for 2.5%. That's the adjustment. That's the adjustment to for my cheating. By waiting to see what the p-value would be. And if it comes out less than 0.1%, so I win all 3 bets, then I turn $3 into $1,120, because I won all 3 bets, 1,000. money, I get about a quarter of 1%. So that's still pretty good. It's not a tenth of 1%, but it's 0.3%. So this is my way of adjusting p-values. So now the any questions about this? So the problem with the course is that this is just one way of doing it. I decided to make these three bets. You might say, well, I want to make four bets. Because if it comes out one in a million, I want to claim even more credit. Or, you know, you just chose these three arbitrarily. I want to make a different choice. So there's all kinds of choices. You can make all kinds of choices. What choice am I going to recommend? I should pick out something simple and give a recommendation for the choice I would like to make. Now, in general, these three choices, the question is picking out. So we've got an interval of possible p-values from 0 to 1. We're really interested in what's close to 0. And I picked out 5% and 1% and 0.1%. I picked out three p-values down here and put equal weights on them. But obviously, I could spread my weights over this any way I wanted. Instead of putting them on a third here, a third here, a third here, I could spread them by some density. I could use some density, a probability density, but it's not really, I'm not thinking of the probability density, just a density of weights. A density of weights, something that integrates up to one, or adds up to one. I could choose that however I want it. A zillion ways of doing it, but I have a favorite way. I have a favorite way, and my favorite way uses the density 1 over 2 times the square root of x. I'll use black this time. So 0, 1. When x is close to 0, I'm dividing by a very small number, so this is infinitely big. So there's an asymptote here, and it comes down, and when x is equal to 1, I've got 1/2. So it's got an asymptote here, and it comes down to 1/2. Something like that. So I spread my money over different values like that. And if I do that, I can do some calculus to find out what the adjustment is. When I get a p-value, how should I adjust it? And it turns out the adjustment is take the square root of p. I like that because it's simple. So my theory ends up with saying, if you see a p-value and the guy didn't tell you what the significance level was at the beginning, take the square root. That's pretty rough. That's pretty rough. If the p-value is 1%, the square root is 1/10. Pretty rough. But that is, you know, what it would take to make it into something game theoretically legitimate. Now, I actually will allow a little more than that. There's really no reason to put any p-value on very high values of p. So maybe I will take this and really only run it up to 1/10 and stop right there and spread all my money there. And that, when I do that, it turns out half of the density is here, and the other half is here, so I get to divide that number by 2. So my actual recommendation is take the square root and divide by 2. So if I take the square root and divide by 2, what's that going to do? If you get a significance level of 1%, I take the square root, I get 1/10, I divide by 2, I get 5%. 10% divided by 2 is 5%. So your significance level of 1%, to me, that's 5%. If you didn't tell me the significance level in advance, if you just let it see what it was and then announce the p-value, I think you're already cheating a little bit. To make it legitimate from a game-theoretic point of view, this is one way of doing it. A rule of thumb, something I can do in my head. I like it because, I mean, you can make up any rule, but this one I can do in my head. I don't know, I've done a lot of math, so the square root is not, I mean, I don't really exactly calculate the square root. But I know that the square root of 100 is 10, and the square root of 10,000 is 100. So I know the square root of, you know, what else do I know? Some things like that. So that is calculating. That is how to adjust game theoretically for a little bit of cheating. Now, the question is, I should pause. Does anybody want to talk about that or ask a question?
So is it means that we try to discount the significant level for the p-value?
Yeah, it's discounting the p-value. This is only the tip of the iceberg, right? Because I started by saying this sort of fact that p-values are cheating a little bit is just the tip of the iceberg, because as I started out by explaining, we're doing a lot more cheating than that. When we dice, you know, when we slice and dice the data and try all kinds of different dependent variables and manipulate the data, we're doing a lot more cheating than that. So what is the, this is a big cultural problem. It's a problem of science, and it's a real problem. I mean, and of course we've got these, I don't want to talk too much politics in the class, but we have a lot of critics of science in political power nowadays. So we're going to have to come to terms with that criticism. You know, I guess they're not gotten to the point of criticizing accountants yet. They're criticizing statisticians in the census, and they're criticizing, you know, people who do climate science and things like that. But we will have our turn. So we need to think about how we can deal with these issues about our own agent problem or our own agency problem. So what is my general message? My general message would be that we need to develop explicit understandings of the game you're playing. What is the game when we are manipulating the data, when we are trying different things out? What is the game we are playing? What I would advocate, and it's not going to happen in my lifetime, but what I would advocate is that in order to publish a paper, you have to include an explanation of what your data search was. If you're a psychologist, you have to include a discussion of what other experiments you did to get to this one. And maybe you should do some game-theoretic calculations and take that into account in how much you would have multiplied your money if you had to include all the betting you did. to get to a bet that made money. You're not just multiplying your money in this experiment, but you've also lost some money on some previous experiments. How much did you multiply your money? The money that you actually put on the table, how much was it multiplied? That's a pretty, you know, I've said this, you know, your future colleagues are not very crazy about this idea that if you're trying to write a dissertation with empirical research, you might not like it either. You know, I asked a psychologist, I asked a social psychologist that does these kinds of experiments, if it was conceivable that that kind of a cultural change could happen. And, you know, his reaction was it just seems like such a tremendous change in culture, it seems impossible to proceed. And I gave a talk, I gave a shorter version of this talk to an accounting meeting. You know, one of my senior colleagues said, what incentive would people have to do what you're suggesting? And I said, well, my response was the incentive might be that he might want people to believe him or her. So the task would be to create an environment where you need to explain what you did in order for people to take you seriously. That's a long ways down the road, but maybe in your lifetime, these issues may become more more salient. It doesn't have a very much of an absolute meaning because you could make more other things going on just by expanding the universe you're looking at. Let me give an example. Suppose you studied the effect of level of education on income for nurses, you'd get one R squared. Now, suppose you expanded it, instead of just nurses, you looked at all occupations. you would get a lower R squared. Because there's more things going on. When you were looking at nurses, you were looking at, you weren't looking at so many other influences. So the R squared by itself is very subject to the definition of the problem. But if you're interested in causality, what you should focus on, what may not be so sensitive to the size of your problem, or shouldn't be, is the regression coefficient. So if you look at the regression coefficient and focus on that, so let's say this is the regression coefficient beta. Now, if the t statistic for beta is bigger than 2, what that means is that you have a 95% confidence interval that does not include 0. So your estimate of beta is statistically significant at the 5% level. It means you're 95% sure that beta is not 0. But the question is, what is beta really? Okay, it's not 0, but how big is this number there? And what does it mean substantively? So substantively, it means that if you look at different values of beta, or rather, if this is beta for the variable x, and you're looking at the effect of x on y, then when x is 1 unit greater, then y should be beta units greater. That's the supposed causal difference. So if the model is meaningful, if it's accurate, if it's telling you something meaningful, it's telling you that when you look at cases where beta is bigger, this is how much bigger y will be. So if you look at an amount of, if you look at a difference in beta that is reasonable, or, I mean, if we're looking at the, effect of sugar per day on whether you have diabetes, and you say, well, if people consume, the people that consume 1 cup of sugar more, which is a lot, but there are people that consume 1 cup of sugar more than I do, how much higher is the probability of diabetes for people that consume 1 cup of sugar more? Maybe 1 cup of sugar more increases the probability of diabetes by 10%, I don't know. So that would tell you something substantive. If eating 1 cup of sugar more per day increases the probability of diabetes by 1/1,000,000th, but you're 95% sure that 1/1,000,000th is accurate at greater than 0, there you have a significant result that doesn't mean much substantively. So generally, I would talk about statistical significance and substantive significance, but substantive significance is measured not by the R squared, but by what beta means. By what beta means. The estimated value of beta, the value of beta, I said focus on this, but I guess I'm saying, what I would really say is focus on the smallest you think beta is. If you think beta is at least this much, is that enough to make any difference, to be meaningful? You know, increasing the probability of diabetes by 1/1,000,000th is not enough for anybody to get. Maybe it does increase it by enough to care enough. That's a substantive judgment that you have to make about the beta. And I've always been disappointed in accounting seminars that generally it's hard to figure out the beta. That's address even in the paper at all, it's buried somewhere. And I've never heard, I seldom hear, I mean, you haven't seen me show up at too many accounting seminars lately, because I've got, I'm 71 years old and I have other things I want to do, but I've gone to a lot of them, and in my experience, I seldom hear the speaker talk about beta. That's what I would ask for. What is the beta? What is the lowest value you think beta can be based on your study? How much difference does it make? Sometimes it's in there. Sometimes. Other, that was a very, I mean, thank you for asking the question. And I have, you know, a few more minutes to talk and a lot of topics, so the questions you're interested in are more important than what I might go to next. If there's anything else that people might talk about. Yeah.
So now, machine learning, and you
machine learning, the focus has been more on prediction than on the betas. That is true. Are you in accounting or accounting information systems?
AIS.
So in AIS, are you, you're interested in prediction?
Risk assessments using machine learning to predict risk assessments, for example, one of the big areas.
Thank you.
wouldn't, so whether leaving a variable out of the neural network would make a difference, that wouldn't, and then you could analyze on the side the difference that leaving the variable out made. I think that would be an interesting approach. The when I was talking about my syllabus, these methods I was mentioning, the game theory forecasting and the conformal prediction are supervised learning methods, or what we call online prediction methods, for what it's worth. Other comments or questions? Give some references for the things I emphasized in my talk today. I mentioned that I published a, these slides, I guess, are on Blackboard for the course here today. So slide 22, I think there's 100 slides because, you know, I kind of put into it other things that I might talk about. But slide 22 has a list of references that includes my 2001 book on game theory probability. It was called Probability of Finance was the name of it. And we have a website that has a lot of working papers. And the idea of adjusting p-values that I just told you about is in one of those working papers. And the story about Fermat and Pascal and the old woman and the Spanish picture and all that, that story is in an article that is about to appear in a journal called Statistical Science. It's actually an introduction to a translation of a chapter from a book in French. But it was by some very dear friends of mine. I translated a chapter of their book. I will just show you another book. This is, I mentioned that the belief function theory for combining different kinds of evidence is sort of lies behind my originally coming to this department because this method was being used so much in auditing. New summer, anyway, we were very interested in the theory of it. Peter Gillett, who is one of the professors in the accounting department of New Brunswick, before he came back to graduate school, he build an expert system for using this in auditing, and the book I published was in 1976, and I never actually wrote a paper with Professor Dempster, but he was the, it was his work that I had used, and he and I have talked over the years. So how old is Art now? Art is almost 90. And he is still interested in this theory. In fact, he's very, he wants me to work on it more instead of this game theory probability stuff. So that's a book I wrote. So what is this? This is all about my books. I wrote a book about causality in 1996. The game theory probability was in 2001. I have a co-author on it, Professor Voff, who is from Ukraine and got his PhD in Russia, in Moscow, and now teaches in England, is my co-author. He's much more mathematical than me, but this is what I spend most of my time thinking about, is this game theory of probability. This guy's been very influential. And then in 2005, my co-author, Professor Boff, and some other people wrote a book that on a machine learning method that we called conformal prediction. And this is a way of getting confidence intervals in supervised learning that uses less assumptions than most methods. So this is also something that there's a lot of, this method has a lot, there's actually providing software for it. And there's actually software that can do regression using this method. So these are some of the things that, this is some of the expertise I've accumulated in the course of my career that I will talk about a little bit when I teach this course. So I think that it's not really time to start a completely different topic. Oh, this was one. This is entertaining. Well, this is all about me. But I thought, you know, which of these? So we all go nowadays and look at Google Scholar to see how many people have cited our different books. So the problem is, I think the most important thing I have done is probability in finance. It's only a game, but it only has 415 citations. Whereas my 1976 book has 16,000 citations. What? Okay, not too exaggerated. 15,512. That was a few weeks ago. So maybe that's 16,000 now. I don't know. So that's what I'm well known for, but it's not what I think most about now. But if you want to know about it, I can also include it in the class. That's why I got my jobs was because of that book. Professor Vasquez-Helly probably thinks I should talk about that book. So I didn't have any break. They didn't give you a break. I just kept going. So I think I can let you out 10 minutes early. So thank you very much for your attention.